But if we can't be there, we can have the next best thing, and we can talk with il proprietario, Alessandro Mori of Il Maranetto. Alessandro, ciao.
Ciao, Tom. Ciao, Tom. Nice to be here with you and with all the guys, the friends that are looking for us now.
Thank you. Thank you.
You are in Chicago in your apartment. I am here in the house that you have behind you, exactly in what I call the library of my life. So all the collection of old vintages of Il Maranetto that are sleeping here in this corner of my farm that is so important for me.
That's I wish we were all there right now. That's a great place to be. So thank you. Yeah. Sandro Manella says, ciao, Tom and Alessandro. So how are you doing? How is your family doing? How is everybody at the winery doing? How is your health?
For the coronavirus?
Yes.
Here in Siena, we can see that here in Montalcino, Siena, so in the area of Siena, we live in a in an island quiet, because we have really few cases, and we stay really carefully close in the house, everybody's house, and so there is no possibility to pass one to the other one. But every day we have, every week, maximum one case when it succeeded. So really nothing. We are lucky. We are lucky, very lucky.
Yes. And of course, you're fortunate because you work producing wine, so you have to go out in the vineyards.
And the farm have absolutely go on. So we come to work. For us, it's very important because every day I move from Siena to Montalcino, because you know that I live in Siena. So I arrive in Montalcino, and it's an important possibility for us to move. And when I say to move, it means that I come in the place that you have behind you. So there is so many air and freedom, and not so many things change for us in this moment, because the farm is important to listen ourselves free.
How has the growing season progressed so far? How, with the winter and the spring, did you get much rain? Is it been good hot temperatures? How are things going?
Till this moment is a good spring.
Good. I'm glad to hear that. So
the nature gone. The problem is for us, you know, for the men, the people, you know, for the nature. Nature till this moment there is a sun. Today the day today is exactly like the picture that you have become you. There is a blue sky in the eye, so much good.
Good, beautiful. And just last question about this before I have so much to talk about, but have you been affected much in terms of sales? Or, I mean, you're a small winery, so, you know, how has that gone in terms of the last 3 weeks, 4 weeks for sales?
For sales?
Yes.
So that is a very is an argument that is difficult to finish in two words. But Il Maranetto is Il Maranetto. I think that everyone take, we have a kind to say in Italy that everyone, cioè, ognuno raccoglie ciò che semina. You take from the ground what you put before inside. So, means that Il Maranetto work, I worked for a very long period to speak to the people all over the world, going personally to explain everything regarding me, regarding my history in wine clubs or everywhere, restaurants. I speak a lot with the people, to wine collectors or wine lovers. Today, Il Maranetto, about 80% of my bottles go in the private sellers.
Okay.
In this atmosphere, with this problem of the virus, everyone is closed at home. So the people drink home, not drink in the restaurant, not drink in moving like the wine tourism and so on. And so El Maroneto is the perfect condition for El Maroneto because a lot of people can buy directly from my importers. As usually, El Maroneto can drink El Maroneto home. And believe to me, Tom, in these 3 months, I increase minimum 30% of the request of my wines.
Oh, that's great. That's fantastic.
Yes, it's great. For me, it's really great.
Yes.
The problem for me this year is to decide who has to have my wine, who not. And I decided that in this so terrible moment that we are living, I accept the order, previous payment, so the people pay me and I send the wine to the importers, no singularly to home.
Right.
And maybe that there will be a lot of my usual importers that will not have my wines, like I'm so sorry, but Brazil, Korea, Taiwan, or Hong Kong, everyone that are waiting to pay the wine.
Right.
I have to be honest. I have to be honest.
That's fine.
Concrete in this moment, they will not have the fantastic 15 of Il Maroneto. The 15 is really so fantastic vintage, exactly like the 16 that is coming.
Okay. One question about importers. I don't know who imports your wine in the United States. Do you have several importers in the United States?
I export in the United States just one wine bowl. The wine bowl from New York and New Jersey.
A wine bowl, okay.
Just one.
Right, I didn't realize they had that. Okay, thank you.
Just one importer all over the world. I have just one importer for every state.
Each country, okay, that makes it easy.
I work with about 28 different countries in the world.
Okay, great. Well, one quick question from one of the attendees and then we'll move on, but he wants to know about if an event such as the Palio in Siena or the Sagra del Tordo in Montalcino, if those will be put on this year or that they've been canceled. Do you know anything about that?
Not this year. Not this year, my friend.
Not this year, okay.
In Siena, the mayor decide and the organization decide they don't make the usual Palio. I have no idea if they organize something end of September, of October, but regular Palio and the events in Montalcino are out. We passed directly to 2001.
Okay, of course. Tell us about, I've been to Montalcino several times, but I've not visited your estate. So I know many of the wineries almost surround the town, north and south, east and west. Where exactly are you at?
Sorry?
Where exactly? Dove si trova la tua azienda?
Yes, where is Il Maroneto? Il Maroneto is very close, the walls of Montalcino. It's just 50, 100 meters out of the gate, the door, Porta Burelli, the door Burelli, that is the north side of the hill of Montalcino. I am the tallest farm in the north side of the hill. The view that you have behind you is all the Val d'Orcia, Val d'Arbia, and so and exactly in front there is the Casentino. The Polar Star is exactly in front of my farm.
Okay, and you have how many hectares planted?
I of a vineyard on totally. Vineyard.
Okay. Quanti?
Allora, di vine, in vineyard, quanti ettari?
Sì.
Di vineyard is in totally now 7.2 hectares. Of these 7.2 hectares, I have 6.6 hectares, 100% Brunello grape. And just last year, I found it to rent the 0.7 hectare of Rosso di Montalcino. So finally, from the 19, the vintage 19, I will make a few quantity of Rosso di Montalcino directly, because till this moment, my Rosso di Montalcino is the Brunello di Montalcino bottled just 2 years old, so okay. Young, that's fresh.
So as of 2019, you'll have specific vines dedicated.
Yeah.
For Rosso di, okay. And is there a regulation on the minimum age for vines to produce the Brunello, or is and the Rosso usually is younger vines, correct?
The Rosso is younger. The Rosso, you can exit in the market the year immediately after the vintage. So in September after, for the vintage 2018, for example, in okay. September of 2019, I can exit with the Rosso di Montalcino. The Brunello di Montalcino is totally different.
Right.
We have to, the wine have to remain a minimum 4.5 years in our cellar for the seasoning and so on. And so we exit after 5 years.
Okay.
The vintage 2019 will be in the market in the 2024.
Right. And with the Rosso, you said you can release it about a year after the harvest. And if I'm correct, it does not require any aging in wood. Is that correct?
But it depends from farm by farm. Of course, for example, my Rosso di Montalcino stay for a minimum 20, 22 months because, but this is a long argument, because I use a natural kind to process to make a wine perfect. So all my wine, the Rosso di Montalcino too, Rosso di Montalcino that, as you understand, the born like Brunello, have to make a natural sedimentation because I never filter the wine, have to make a very slowly malolactic fermentation that usually in my case born the springtime after the harvest. So, and the minimum take 3, 4, 5 months. So is a natural processing of gone, and the wine is a perfect in every his part, in every his evolution. So I'm speaking alcoholic, malolactic, right. Sediment, natural sedimentation, and so on. Took about a couple of years. So the wine make 20, 22 months in barrels, and after I bottled the like Rosso. The other wine continued to the long way in barrels to became Brunello. And the difference from the Rosso di Brunello is that in the Rosso you found the fresh, fruity smells and just more living colors instead of the Brunello. The Brunello have more evolved the smells. The fruity became more evolved in flowers and so on.
Yes, yes, okay. Let's back up before we talk more about the wine production. Let's back up a little bit with the history. Your father, it is Giuseppe, see? He founded the estate or purchased or planted some vines in what, 1974, I believe, right?
Yes, the first meeting was in October 73. And the contract was made in April 74. In 75, we start to make, with my brother, I was 14 years old in that period, we start to make the first harvest. And so I have about 45 vintages in my back.
Okay. And was it these first few wines, were they labeled as Brunello di Montalcino, or was it just an experiment?
No, not experiment. We never make an experiment because we start to make the wine for the joke of the weekend. So we start to make the wine for our houses, some friends, and so on, as usually. Think that I come from a family of lawyers. Everyone are lawyers in my family. And I used to be a lawyer too in my past. So our way was the way of the lawyers. But this is more like a joke. I slowly the joke became for me a big passion. I used to be a lawyer, but continually arrive in the farm to follow my wines and so on. After I decided to take my hand 100% of the farm when I was about 32 years old. In that case, the farm became for me a style of life because I take out in my mind the desk and arrive the tractor. So I start to work seriously handling in the farm early in the morning, because every hour of light was important when you work in the country early in the morning, and till late in the afternoon. And now it's completely something different, because the style of life became for me like a kind to speak with the people. So it's a kind of art. It's the kind to express my personality and to let the people understand what I have to say between my wines.
Right. And I would imagine that you can express your philosophy a lot better making wine than you could in a court of law, right? All right.
So regarding the label, so your answer, we started to make the wine in 75, but the first vintage bottle that was the 1980. In 1980, that one that is behind me, exactly that one, and today remained to me only 12 bottles.
Wow. Okay. One question about with the vineyards, going back to that, is there any thought that you might purchase some new vineyards and maybe at a higher elevation? And that the question kind of coexists with climate change. And has there been a big change in the climate when you harvest the grapes, or have you had to make many changes in the vineyard in terms of green harvest or things like that?
No, Tom. In the starting of the history of Il Maronito, this elevation, the vineyard is 420 meters on the sea level. This elevation was a problem because think that usually it was the last that started the harvest in Montalcino about the middle of October, because we That's never right. arrived with the perfect maturation. But today, and believe to me, the climate is changed absolutely. Today is something of fantastic, because I explained to you that we are in north. The view for us is north, and with the changing of the wind, thermic wind, thermic wind means mm-hmm. something for you. I don't know. The in the morning, the wind arrived from the sea and entered in the ground. In the afternoon, late afternoon, the wind arrived from the ground, so from the north in my side, in my case, and they go to the sea, no? So now it's warm during the day. It's really seriously warm. But these fresh winds that arrive late afternoon from the north that go to the sea make this relax for the plant. So now really we arrive to a perfect maturation, because the changing of temperature day and night is very important for the maturation of the grape, and we are able to make our harvest about 4, 5, 7 of October, the 2nd of October, say. Okay. It depends. So now we arrive to a perfect maturation in that period. In the past, middle of October, but some peak is still green. So this changing of the climate for us was perfect. In fact, the north side of the hill of Montalcino now is considered the area where the grape found the perfect equilibrium in elegance, in velvet, in silky, and in color, in smells. There is nothing that is aggressive. So this changing helped a lot of the winemakers in my area.
Yeah, because I understand that this south of Montalcino was a little bit hotter. So with the climate change.
South of Montalcino, I have the problem, the opposite problem. I said to you that in the morning, the wind arrived from the sea to the ground. So bring with the wind, bring the salt that go to finish to the waves of the plants, mm-hmm. and after there is the warm of the day with the salt of the waves, so it's a problem. And they need really the helping of the water Every vineyard in now in the south, I have the water that during the day go pick by pick or drop by drop.
Okay. Now you in the cellar, you use only grandi botti, sì?
Solo grandi botti. Okay. You can see in my left side we have just 26 hectolitres big barrels.
And
so 2,600
liters. 2,600
liters,
thank you. And I understand that you use both the Slavonian and Allier from France, correct?
I have only three bottles of Slavonia that are the original barrels of Il Maroneto. Both two of 19, so 1,900 liters, one 1,700 liters from 77, 78, and 79. All the other one is Allier.
And why did you make the change to Allier?
No one barrel exit from my cellar, never. Only enter, never change barrels. Every barrel is perfectly functioning in my cellar because we are, you can imagine that I am so fixed with the cleaning, maniacal, I can say maniacal. And so every barrel make perfectly his work. For me, the work of the barrel is only to let the wine have a contact with outside, so it's an osmosis. And so they let the wine make the seasoning inside, changing, touching the changing of the season, the temperature, the pressing. And so I don't use the barrel to give tannini or to give smells, wood smells to the wine. So more old is a barrel, better is for me because I can conserve and preserve the own smells of the grape and the wine.
You get more
yes
variety from the purity, excuse me, from the Sangiovese. So okay,
absolutely. I am one of the eight poor winemakers selected from the Italian governments, like through Sangiovese maker.
Oh, that's great! Congratulations. Let me go back just to 1974, when it was a very different world in Montalcino. Okay. What was it like then?
It's totally another world, totally different, completely different. We are pioneers in that period. Today there is a lot of in money investments, and but in that period it was a really pioneer and a passionista. Think, I can say to you, all together, we born together with Piero Palmucci. I can speak regarding, of course, Gianfranco Soldera or Diego Molinari, and so on. Every one of us come here with the pleasure to enjoy this country and to try. Never want to speak regarding Brunello di Montalcino at that period.
Yeah, that was a much more innocent time, wasn't it, back in Montalcino?
Yes.
I have a question here from one of the attendees. He wants to know, you know, in Chianti Classico these days, they're talking a lot about Sottozona. And is that something that is being discussed in Montalcino in terms of, you know, the Brunello will be identified as to what particular district or what subzone the grapes are sourced from?
Allora, Tom, if we speak regarding Sottozona, I can accept that. Sottozona, you can speak regarding the different area from Montalcino. So we have the north side that is the valley that they have behind you. We have an area that look to the mountain, is another sottozona. So Castelnuovo dell'Abate with Poggio di Sotto, with all that farm. And we have another sottozona that is the place that look to the sea, where we have Argiano, Poggione, Coldorcia, and so on, Lavafi. But and so I accept that, but I don't accept the idea of zonazione. La zonazione is something that is impossible, in my opinion, to make in Montalcino, because we have so many different kind of ground, altitude, climb, so many. Every place is completely different from the other one. So I prefer to speak of exactly like in Piemonte or exactly like in Burgundy, of crew. partly we have to speak of crew. For example, the vineyard that you have behind you, that is the Madonna delle Grazie, is the only one that is 420 meters on the sea level. Is the sand, the material of the beach for 74%. I have no other vineyard around me. I have a count to work in that vineyard that is so particular. It's more than 35 years that no one worked the ground. It's just a meadow behind the grapes that lives in a so particular area and the macroclimate atmosphere. So that is a crew, no zone action.
That's interesting. I appreciate that opinion. On that subject, I have a question here from Charlie Artarola. Charlie, ciao. He wants to know your zone, if you can compare it to the zone of Camigliano.
Totally different. In other words, Montalcino is a hill. It's a hill. That is nice because it's a hill with not so many hectares of grape. But from Maroneto to Camigliano, there is a world. There is a completely different exposition, the completely different composition of the ground, and different philosophy of growing up from the grape, from the vineyard to the cellar, and so on and so on. So it's totally different conception of wine, my idea. We have the same grape, but pay attention. The grape is the same for everyone. Yeah. It's not so true because I repeat that the Brunello, the Sangiovese take the characteristic of the first 60 centimeters from the humus. So change the humus, change totally. You have the sand or stones or clay are different grape. But with the same clay grape, everyone have a kind to express himself, the philosophy to bring totally different. So it's impossible to compare Maroneto with Camigliano, surely, for the area, for the lot of things.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about, now your current release is for both the Brunello and for the Brunello Madonna della Grazia. It's 2015, and I've been tasting a few. I have your wine to taste yet. I'm looking forward to it. I wanted to get this out of the way and then I would celebrate and try your Brunello. So I know the 2015 is a very, very special vintage, and some people are saying it's one of the best in the last 25, 30 years. Having been to Tuscany last year and throughout Canada Classico, I tasted many great 2016 wines as well. And I know that producers there say these are two back-to-back really outstanding vintages. And I wondered if I could get your thoughts on both vintages, 2015 and 2016.
There is a more easily question, no? I have to answer to this one. are two different wines, and both are really, really, both are fantastic. Okay. Personally, I love the 16 more than 15.
Okay.
I repeat that, Tom, everything I say is just my personality opinion. That is important because I can't say that for every one of us is that they're all the same. But the 15 was a very easy. Both are 5 stars, so both are fantastic. Right. But it was an easy vinification, it was an easy harvest. But in my idea, there is the conception that the best things arrive when there is something of an unusual back. So the Madonna, the Brunello 16 generally was a warmer period, a warmer year, warmer. The grape was maybe more aggressive. It was not so easy the vinification, and the Brunello 16 is a vintage that have to stay alone without so many changing the barrels to the other barrels. For example, I every 4 months I clean the barrels, so everyone change the barrels. So for the 16, several times I decided to pass the step. Instead of 4 months, I leave the wine 8 months in the barrel, because I found that he's evolving slowly. Till last year, but now we are in April, till everyone, if you ask to every one of us, till last August, September, the people think this 16 is so difficult, we don't understand. Okay, at the end, he found his equilibrium now. And the tasting of the wine from the barrel, I have that also. I go to bottle it in a couple of months now. Okay. Now is still in barrels. If you go to test the wine from the barrels, now found a soup melody. Is the orchestra that finally found the perfect combination of all the instruments. And now is really perfect. So wait for the 16, drink the 15, enjoy your 15, wait the 16, because my idea, the 16 is perfect, is fantastic to take and save in the cellar, because it's a wine that will have so very long life, a wine that found so long time to find his equilibrium, to perfect equilibrium, surely will save and will conserve this equilibrium for a very long time.
Great. You know, just hearing you and watching you describe these two vintages is fascinating. I mean, you have such passion just in the way your eyes light up and the way you just talk about this. So that's, if at the very least, that's great salesmanship, but obviously, you know, that's not what you're about. You're about, you know, these are your wines. These are your children, so to speak. And it's great.
It's more than my wine. It's my creator.
Yes. Okay. I have a couple of questions here from some of the attendees. And since you talked about 15, about you can drink these now, they want to know how you compare 2015 with other vintages. One gentleman asks about how you compare it with the 2010. Another gentleman wants to know how it compares with vintages like 2001 and 1997, how would you answer that?
But no, with the 2010. 2010 is exactly like the 16. The 2010 is another one that need the 2010 is 2010, finish point, closed. Closed. 2010.
Okay.
16. The 15 is comparated. My opinion, I found in the 15 some characteristic of the 208. Personally, I love my 208. Personally, okay. Today I think that my 208 is the best Marronetto moving now in the country. Because now it's perfect in every part, and this is so soft, so harmony in the mouth. The 208 had only one big problem. The 208 arrived after the 207. You think that is obvious, but it's not so obvious. Because the 207 was a wine that in the origin take unbelievable wine, the best wine of the century, everyone buys, yes. Was the big truffle, la grande truffle, grande bluff, the big bluff, because right. In reality, after the end, after 5 years, it was not so perfect like the other one. So everyone buy the 207. Everyone, you can put the normal water inside the bottle, everyone crazy, buy. So all the sellers became private sellers, restaurant sellers, became full of 207, and the people wait to buy the 208. When it was the moment in September, the people have to decide or wait at the 209 or buy the 208. So the 208 pass like the stupid brother of the other vintages. But in reality, the 208 was a very, very, very lovely wine. And I found some characteristics with the 215. The 215 found this velvet. The 15 is is like a nice lady that is perfect in every part. But generally, the nice lady perfect in his part is less aggressive or less impressing, like a bomb, a lady bomb, a fantastic lady that is 16, that is 10. The 8, the 15 are more elegant, more harmony around.
Okay, you know, if I wrote that comparison in an article, I'd be in trouble, but as a producer, you can say that, but that's okay. I was going to ask you, because you have the Brunello di Montalcino and you have the Madonna della Grazia, which is a selezione, not a riserva. I have a question here from a panelist. He says, are you going to make another riserva? Did you make a riserva in the past, or?
This moment, I make the reserve at the 13, as you know, last year, just in big magnum, only 1,500 bottles for all over the world, something really exceptional, because that arrived from the barrel number 18, that for me is have something of mystic, that barrel, because all the wine that they put there inside take some characteristic that is unique. So I decided that was my conception of really something of what that there is in my mind to be a reserve. Now I have no idea whether I will make in the future in another reserve. But till this moment, I have there is no this risk. Also because the people call reserve something that for me is a mistake. In the use of the word the reserva, speaking regarding a wine like that one, because there is only the nature can decide when a wine can become a reserva. Only the nature can do it, because the hand of the man can make a serious selection of grape in the vineyard, and after can use a different kind of vinification, and after can put in the particular barrel just one or two little barrels, but that is no reserva. That is a selection. In fact, there is a lot of my colleagues that now change the reserve in a selection. I start to make a selection, never made the reserve. Okay. That is the selection, shows the selection of grape work, the particular in different, but this is a selection, and you can make it every year.
Of course.
Because every year so you can make the selection in the vineyard of the best grape grapes.
Yeah, the best wine
you can make. Grapes. Only sometimes succeeded that in a particular vintage or a particular barrel that change in the cellar. The nature can say, okay, pay attention, this is different. This isn't the one that you make, it's different. So live in the barrel another year and look what succeeded. And after you decide if it's a something that the nature decide that is reserve or not. That is the really exceptional wine that you can really put in the market. Seriously honest with your customers and the people that have to drink it. In the other case, it's only just one label, another label in the label list in the farm, the big farm and so on.
I'm getting a lot of questions here. There's several from my friend Charlie Arturola. Charlie, thank you. I'm not sure we're going to get to all of them. I have a lot of questions left myself. But now, with the wines you make and the wines that your colleagues make, are there? I'm curious about other producers that you really admire, and also when you started, were there wines that you tasted from some of the colleagues back, you know, almost 40 years ago that you said, you know, these are really beautifully made wines and I want my wine to like that? Or did you not even think about it? Was it just, you know, I'm going to make the best wine I can? What was your philosophy? What was your influence?
No, Tom, sorry, but I don't understand what you would like to know.
Oh, I'm sorry. Just when you first made wine back in 1980, the first Brunello, did you have a particular style in mind? Was there a particular producer that whose Brunello you tasted that you said this is great, or was it just you didn't pay attention to that? Was it just your own philosophy?
Charles would like that to speak regarding 45 years of my life, because in that question there is all my life. This is a very lovely question. Very lovely question. Thank I you. Love it. It's fantastic, this question. So when I start to make the wine, the first time that I was 14 years old, I have no idea what it means to drink wine.
Right.
I remember only to test one time, just a pick of wine from a Damigiana, so 55 liters bottle, the Damigiana that we use in Toscana. That right. is the Nello Montalcino made from a customer of my father, lawyer, that was a priest of Castelnuovo dell'Abate. So imagine what it means. We start to make the wine for a play, for just to play. Just my father bought in Maroneto because he was born in Greven County, so would like to return with a little country, with a little farm in the country to joke, to get the plant during the Saturday or Sunday. But we have a little piece of Montalcino. We would like to implant a little part of vina, and we start for the first 5,000 square meters. And with these 5,000 square meters, we start to make the first vintages. So what's the play? I have no idea what it means. My teacher, Mario Cortevesio, that worked with me 8 years, and after his big friend, Giulio Gambelli, following me other 8 years, 9 years. And they learned slowly, slowly to give me the idea of what means make the wine, because Mario Cortevesio presented me saying, hey, pay attention. You start to make the wine for a joke, but it's a serious joke, because this grape took more than 3,000 years to make perfect for this area. And you start to make a wine that was the wine drunk from the people that passed before you. So he gave me just an idea, the respect for the area where I am coming to work. And this was the philosophy that followed me all my life. I always respected the idea and the style and the work of our grandfather here. So there isn't a wine cult that I have to follow where I would like to go. This is my wine, born with me, with this characteristic, and follow me all my life. And today, I continue to make the Brunello di Montalcino exactly like 45 years ago. The Madonna delle Grazie is in my idea that born with me in 1996.
Okay. Allora,
answer very quickly, and the history of 45 years, I hope you understand.
Right. That's a very quick 45 years, yes.
Tom,
allora, per i nostri amici italiani,
sì.
ho due domande.
Sì.
Io chiedo queste domande prima in italiano e poi in inglese.
Vuoi che risponda in italiano o in inglese?
Entrambi. Prima italiano e poi in inglese.
Bene.
Basta così?
Sì.
Ok. C'è stata un'esplosione del produttore di Brunello di Montalcino da quando hai iniziato a produrre Brunello dell'annata 1980. Pensi che questo continuerà o ci sono già troppi produttori per la zona? And for English, there has been an explosion of Brunello di Montalcino producers since you first started producing Brunello from the 1980 vintage. Do you think this will continue, or are there already too many producers in the zone?
Before to answer to you, I would like only to say hello to Domenico Piccoli that entered to see to our friend that is my importer in Brazil.
Oh, wonderful. Okay.
Allora, rispondo prima in italiano.
Prego.
Io cerco anche qui di sintetizzare un concetto abbastanza lungo, cioè un evolversi del tempo. Quando io ho iniziato, come abbiamo detto prima, era un essere pionieri. Eravamo pochissime aziende, andavamo veramente mano nella mano a fare il primo vinitaly nell'84. Poi che cosa è successo? È successo che negli anni 90, fine anni 90, inizio anni 2000, E quasi tutti dei primi tempi eravamo o i latifondi che erano già su Montalcino o dei piccoli giocherelloni che arrivavano a Montalcino e che provavano a fare il vino, a giocare a fare vino. Poi che cosa è successo? Fine anni 90, inizio anni 2000 c'è stata un'esplosione di aziende perché hanno autorizzato a piantare vigneti e hanno contribuito a dare soldi per piantare questi vigneti. E allora tantissimi proprietari di anche piccoli appezzamenti su Montalcino hanno fondato delle aziende. Ma non è così facile fare il vino come sembra, cioè, comunque non tutti, non tutto l'oro luccica, quindi tante aziende hanno cominciato a soffrire un po', chi ha cominciato a vendere il vino sfuso, chi ha cominciato a vendere le uve senza imbottigliare o comunque smettendo di imbottigliare, e tutte queste aziende ora sono state tutto, comunque tante, sono state assorbite dalle aziende più grandi che nel frattempo erano arrivate a comprare e cercavano di comprare sempre di più, comprare sempre di più. Ci sono dei nomi che mi possono venire in mente, anche come il mio carissimo amico Claudio Tipa, che è arrivato, ha comprato Poggio di Sotto e ne ha già comprate altre due. Quindi io vedo che secondo me il futuro non sarà un continuare a crescere il numero delle aziende, ma il numero delle aziende sarà comunque in diminuire, penso, in diminuire, ma per essere accorpate in aziende più grandi e più professionali. Quindi ci sarà comunque meno improvvisazione e ci sarà più professionalità. Now I try to explain this concept in English. So I said that when I started in 1980, 1976, 77, 78, it was really a few group of pioneer guys that try to joke like me with the wine, and we move all together, hand in hand. We make it together the first. I remember in 1984 about the first step in Italy, and sometimes we go together in Paris and in Bordeaux, and we move to speak regarding De Brunello when no one knows De Brunello. We was really 40, 45, 50 maximum farm. About finish 90, starting of 2000 period, the new millennium, there was an explosion of a lot of new farms, but because the European Community help open the big book of the vineyard, so permit to implant and give money to help for the implanting in the people that have a piece of ground in Montalcino, just owners of a piece of ground, everyone can implant a new vineyard of Brunello and one and a half vineyard of Brunello and one and a half hectare of Rosso di Montalcino. So in that period, a lot of people that lives in Brunello. So I have no idea the infirmier or the doctor of the people that work in the supermarket. Everyone was the owner implant one and a half hectare of vineyard of Brunello and one and a half of vineyard of Rossi Montalcino. But it's not so easy to make the wine. Not all the gold is yellow. Eh? So it's not so easy as the people can think. The people did it's the Brunello. Okay, it's easy. We make the Brunello and we sell the Brunello, a lot of money because every bottle say I would like. But after all, a lot of this one understood that it's difficult to make the comparison in the markets and so on. So stop to bottle it. Maybe that sell only the Brunello in liters, or just start to sell the grape. And so big farm, big reality are going slowly, slowly in Montalcino and by this little reality. And I think that the future will be, I repeat, another one that I can remember, I can speak now, is Tomasi from Amarone, or Allegrini from Amarone, or Claudio Tipa, repeat that, and so on. So there is less little farms, there is a more bigger reality with less no ability to sell and so on, and so more professionality. So in my idea, there is a Montalcino with a bigger reality and a more professionality in making the wine and selling the wine. I have no idea how this will be able to save and protect the Montalcino territoriality, but the professionality will be surely more important than in this moment.
Yes, okay, thank you. We're running out of time here, just have a couple minutes. So from your friend Domenico Piccoli, he says, what do you expect from the future? You sort of answered that question, but what's
Domenico, this is an argument that we have to make face-to-face.
Okay, all right.
I think that the price of Il Maroneto will arrive to the stars. I'm joking.
I'll have to skip the second question in German, excuse me, German and Italian, but just you have earned so many great reviews, meritato, and it just, you know, every year you look in the wine guides and there's three stars or five stars or three glasses. Do you even pay attention to those anymore? I wonder if does it become routine to you, or is it something that gets excited all the time, or do you even care about the reviews?
When you speak so quickly,
Tom, I'm sorry,
I am able to take one word on two, and so it's okay. Not so easy to understand the question.
I'll ask again. With all the great reviews you get, and,
yes,
and all the newsletters in Italy as well as international press.
Yeah.
Yes. Your reviews are as high as anyone in Montalcino, and I wonder if that is something that it inspires you, or does it not even matter? I mean, are you going to make your wine the same way every year, right?
Surely, absolutely. I don't make the wine for the journalist. I make the wine for the final customers. And so I don't make the wine for me. No, it's not true. I make the wine for you. And I repeat to you that, as I said to you at the starting of this interview, I try to speak with the people with my wines. And if I change something, I change to permit the people to understand all the evolution that led me where I am now.
Okay.
So, Mario Cortevesio learned me to be maniacal in the cleaning, and today I am maniacal in the cleaning. And Mario Cortevesio learned me to respect, and today I continue to respect. So it's very easy. I try really to say in two words, it's very easy, Tom. I spend a so fantastic period when I was young here in Montalcino with my brother, my mother, my father. Then all the memory of that moments are so clean in my mind in this moment too, that when I decide to stop with the lawyer, to dedicate all myself to the farm, it's just to let me permit to live every day of my life that fantastic memory that remains so clean in my mind. So changing. Why? In the big period, the big chaos generated from Brunellopoli. Why I remain poor? Because I am hard? No, because changing my kind of work and my style of life, I make a treatment to myself that I decided to return to continue, because I would like to continue the life that I lived when I was young. So all my life is so hard to follow that memory. And today that I am here with my son, Jacopo, I try to pass to him the exactly memory that I have in my mind when I was young, like him now. If I am able to let him understand this one, I permit to him to live a happy life in this fantastic place.
That's wonderful. And your answer is just great. It's I think that's why people love your wine so much. It's not, you can look at wines technically and look at smell the wine and have all the sensations in your mouth, but it's about pleasure. And obviously this is a great pleasure for you. There's great passion. And this has been just great. We have a lot of some other questions. We're just not going to get a chance to try it. We're out of time, but I wish we had another hour because you've been my favorite guest so far of these webinars. It just comes from your soul. And obviously your wine's, the same way. So grazie mille, grazie per l'opportunità. Io spero ci vediamo dopo.
Io sono qui. Ti aspetto.
Ok, grazie. Okay. Ciao, grazie. Ciao.
Okay. Ciao a tutti. Bye bye.
Buona giornata. Ciao. Thank you again. That was great, Alessandro. Thank you again. Ciao.
Ciao.